I was trained as a historian. Then I worked as a journalist. And then, like the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus, was kind of knocked off my horse and converted to librarianship because of the generation of the generosity of librarians. And I've been at the National Security Archive for almost 30 years. I'm here to talk about the topic of the hour, fake news, misinformation, and to say that it's as old as the Greeks leaving a wooden horse out in front of the gates of Troy. It was fake, but boy, was it big news when they opened the gates, right? Or as Mark Twain said, and this was before the internet, the lie goes twice around the world before the truth gets out of bed in the morning, right? Now you got the internet, it's probably 10 times or maybe 100 times around the world before the truth gets out of bed. So what I want to talk about today is that with the internet, however, we have the antidote, which is really primary sources to this flood of misinformation and fake news. And it comes right out of what Barb was talking about. It's the critical thinking skills. I'm going to show some secret documents from Digital National Security Archive that we put together over many years with our partnership with ProQuest. Through our Freedom of Information request, through some great librarians who work to create the metadata so you find the documents that you need. And I'm going to preview some the current sort of newest collections on nuclear weapons and their proliferation. Think about the front pages, Iran, North Korea, right? And also this full set on Iran. Where are the Iranians coming from? It's thousands of primary sources. And then I'm going to, I want to end with what the partnership with ProQuest actually supports, which is an ongoing campaign that we're in the middle of to file Freedom of Information requests, open files that would otherwise stay secret indefinitely, put them together in these curated collections, put metadata on them so people can find the sources they need and publish. But what you're part of when you subscribe or buy the Digital National Security Archive through ProQuest is half the net revenue comes back to support the little National Security Archive to keep doing these requests. So it's a cause, not just a product. So here's my latest favorite fake news. Anybody see how the 500,000 people signed up on Facebook to go storm Area 51 out in the Nevada desert, right? And what happens when they actually show up? It's still an active Air Force base, right? And what was fascinating to me was then it sent a bunch of the reporters back to talk to us. Turns out it was a joke posting on Facebook. But it made them come back to think about the issues of secrecy, because back in 2013, through one of our Freedom of Information requests, we didn't ask for Area 51. We asked for an existing history of the U-2 spy plane that the CIA had written, right? And in that history, it talks about some CIA guys flying over the desert in Nevada, the atomic testing area, seeing a nice salt bed that was a lake in the spring, but otherwise flat, nice bed. Said, oh, this would be a great place for a secret testing facility for our U-2 and Oxcart and other spy planes. They were classified for 50 years. So this history only got declassified in 2013. And in there, they had this wonderful little map. Here's exactly where it is. There's Area 51. That's the history released through the Freedom of Information Act. And it's right next to Las Vegas, but they had real problems getting people to go stay there. So the people at Lockheed Skunk Works renamed the site. They didn't call it Area 51. They were trying to attract people to come work on the test plane. They called it, we're going to name this Paradise Ranch. Paradise Ranch. Footnote. We got real problems. We need more air conditioners. We need more water towers. It gets really hot here, right? But turns out they were not only testing the stealth aircrafts, they also had three or four captured Soviet MiGs that they were essentially deconstructing to figure out what were their systems to prevent our radars from seeing them. And so this is some of the most secret work the U.S. government did. It probably made a huge difference, according to this history, in the 1973 war, where the Israelis, using American planes, the ratio was about 117-1 in terms of planes shot down, Soviet planes on the Syrian and Egyptian side. So made a life and death difference at that point. But it's confirmed, and it's fascinating, because then you get in this dynamic where this story is now picked up all over the world, but with some facts in it, instead of the little green aliens. Everybody remember Independence Day? you know, where the president, the aliens have landed and blown up New York City, and the national security advisor takes the president of the United States down in this bunker under the Nevada desert, and they show him an alien that crash landed years before. It's all in secret in a water tube. And the president looks at the national security advisor, why didn't you ever tell me about this? The national security advisor says, you weren't cleared to know. That's why the National Security Archive exists, because you are citizens of the United States. You're cleared to know, but they don't want you to know. So let me just go to one of my favorite documents of just showing you explicitly. This is from the new nuclear proliferation document collection in DNSA. This we published 15 years ago. These are the 9 steps to build a nuclear bomb. It's a study of the Israeli nuclear program. But the actual status accounting was deleted on national security grounds. B1 is the first exemption to the Freedom of Information Act. But we keep going after these documents. One of the reasons that we exist as an institutional memory is to peel back the black, keep uncovering. If something is as important as this, which is the step-by-step to a nuclear bomb, wow. We might want to know that. Every scholar studying why states do go for nuclear bombs or step back from it would need to know this. Well, this is in the new collection because we now have the steps showing Israelis had accomplished every one of them, 64, 63, 63, 65, 65. Only step 9, preparation of the actual nuclear weapons test. That was the only one they hadn't done. It's fascinating. But this gives scholars a real sense of, okay, what's the challenge on nuclear proliferation? How do we deal with it? And this is one of our closest allies. Turns out that John F. Kennedy was so hostile to this, he had confrontation after confrontation in secret with the Israeli government. But then once Johnson and Nixon came to power, they said, okay, we'll just let them go. As long as they don't flaunt it in people's faces, the bomb program's okay. This is a 1967 study. This is my favorite document from the new proliferation set because it basically says something about the secrecy. That the study, they assigned 3 young PhD physicists with no access to classified information, part-time and in less than 3 years came up with a workable nuclear bomb design. This was called the nth country problem, like who's the next to get a nuclear weapon, right? And this is 1967. The results of the study have some fairly serious arms control implications. No kidding. If 3 kid grad students can make a bomb design with no access to secret information, wow, our world is in real trouble. This study is one of the reasons why the CIA, another new document published in the collection, estimated there'd be upwards of 40 countries with the bomb within a decade or two after 1974. 40 countries. Imagine our world today if that had actually happened. And what's one of the amazing lessons, and I think one of the things that scholars are finding in this huge collection, are some of the reasons why the 40 countries didn't happen. What worked to keep us safe? International Atomic Energy Agency, the whole Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, this nuclear suppliers group that kept people from getting the fissile material, right? And so this is also a lesson in the dogs that didn't bark. Like, what works? And then what should we keep of that? So now there's articles in the last couple issues of International Security about the lessons from what didn't happen, as opposed to, oh my gosh, we're freaked out about North Korea. Well, there were going to be 30 other North Koreas. Wow. Success stories are also part of this, of the whole exposure. And all the while, we've had to fight that. So this came in December 2016 from a Freedom of Information request to the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and it was all blacked out, and we went, our expert, Bill Burr, PhD historian, said, wow, that document looks familiar. I remember his signature. Look at that great signature. I tell you, I've been working on my signature to try to get that loop like that. That's pretty good. And he said, I think I saw that before. Yeah, it turns out we got it in 2010. And he published it in the Nuclear History Collection. But in 2016, they decided, no, it's secret. It would cause serious damage to U.S. national security. And that made us go back and look at the cover letter. This is the cover letter up here. Dear Mr. Burr, right? The Office of the Secretary of Defense and the National Security Council have no objection to declassification in full. However, Mr. Mark Patrick of the Joint Chiefs decided it should be secret. That's what's wrong with our secrecy system. It takes one person and they can keep a blackout. even when the document's previously been released. They just don't know. It's one of the reasons government agencies buy the Digital National Security Archive, because they want to find out what's actually been released, right? I mean, seriously, we wrote a letter to the CIA saying we're publishing all a bunch of documents on Iran, and they put in an order for it, because they're just not aware, and partly they're not aware is because they're living in compartments of secrecy where they don't know the open sources. They don't have a subscription to ProQuest 350 primary source databases, right? And so, and they're precluded from looking at open source stuff like the WikiLeaks stuff, because their security clearances would be at risk. So they're sort of deliberately blinding, and that's a huge problem. One of the things I liked about this document is that it was written in 1986, and it's talking about nuclear war fighting. Nuclear war fighting. It's one of those oxymoronic terms, sort of like, can you really do a nuclear war fighting? And the exact same moment that they're doing this study, the President of the United States is meeting with Gorbachev and saying, oh, well, what I think it would be a good idea, maybe at the end of 10 years, let's get rid of all nuclear explosive devices, bombs, battlefield, cruise missiles, subs, intermediate, so on. Gorbachev, yeah, we could say that. Let's list all those weapons. George Shultz, Secretary of State, then let's do it. How close we got to nuclear abolition. And one of the great, I think, stories for librarians, students are going to look for this document using a search term, nuclear abolition. The word abolition is never used in this entire document. Full text search is not going to get you to this document, right? But our librarians attach the metadata on abolition plans, Gorbachev's abolition plans, Reagan's belief in nuclear abolition, so it becomes a term that then gets you right to these transcripts. If you see on the handout, I don't know, Michelle, did we already... The Soviet-U.S. relations into the Cold War, we published every transcript, both Russian in translation and American, of all their meetings, Geneva, Reykjavik, et cetera. So you've got this, and combined with all the briefing materials and drafts and material on both sides. So it's an incredible lesson and some great what-ifs. What if we've done that? That we got to only, 15 years after the CIA said 40 countries would have nukes. Let me give you one of my favorite documents. We published this in the first Iran collection. Now we've got a new Iran collection. So why am I showing you this old one? Because this was shredded by the CIA station chief when the mob took the embassy, the so-called students, in Tehran in 1979, the hostage crisis. And they spent those hours as the mob gathered and then broke through the walls, shredding every secret document. And so when the so-called students came in, there were these piles of shreds under the various shredding machines. So the students took carpets and put them out on the garage, the old motor pool. And they gathered up the shreds, kept them in their piles, and brought them to certain locations and coded them. Then they brought in rug weavers, their relatives, who were rug weavers, who sat next to the pile and separated the shreds by the type of paper and the bias of the cut. So then they had a bunch of smaller piles. And then at that point, they brought in their English speakers, bunch of fluent English speakers. Remember, the Peace Corps had been in Iran for 20 years. There's lots of English speakers. So the English speakers came in and then matched up the letters on each side. Look how many shreds that is. So there's the P, it's right in the middle. There's the O, there's an E. Oh, wow, that makes the word people. Just imagine that as work. You think cataloging was drudgery at some point? I mean, try that, right? So 1998, we're doing a conference in Tehran, and I meet one of the English speakers who had put together these documents. They published about 80 volumes of these shredded documents over time, over 6 or 8 years. And she was working for the new reform government of Hatami in Iran. And I said, wait a second, back then you were one of the hostage takers, imprisoning those, you know, the Satans, the great Satan, the Americans. And now you're working for the reformer who wants to have dialogue? What's up with that? She said, well, I spent about 6 or 8 years putting together the shredded documents. And at the end of that time, talk about critical thinking, she said, I started believing the CIA ran everything in my country. And we're totally behind the Shah and everything evil that he did. And by the end, I realized they're just another bureaucracy. They didn't have a clue about the Ayatollah and the revolution. They were totally dependent on the Shah and his information. So that was really interesting because it gave me a different view. I wouldn't say that she's at the point where she's ready to criticize the supreme leader. So critical thinking still has a ways to go in the theocracy that is Iran, but the transition from where she was as a hostage taker to where she became is fascinating, and a little bit of primary source made a huge difference. More from the current, this is the memo from Bruce Langen, who was the number two in the embassy, saying, please don't let the Shah in. This is in, July 1979. We know he's sick, but please don't let him in. The mobs have already rushed the embassy three times. We're at real risk here. Please don't let him in. So that was July. Then come, this is Zbigniew Brzezinski to Jimmy Carter. So October 20th, well, Shah's really sick. David Rockefeller's leaned on the Secretary of State. We're thinking we should probably let the Shah in New York. And then it says here, the president called late on Saturday night giving his approval. All right, that's October 20th. November 4th, the mobs took the embassy, 444 days. But what you can see, this is all in the new Iran collection, the backstage arguments over the policy and the analysis of the Shah and the damage it did to us, and I would say for our long-term relationships all over the Middle East. So this is after the hostage taking, December 79. You've got Zubig writing this whole memo, what we can do to Iran. And down at the bottom, this fabulous little J, that's Jimmy Carter's handwriting. And give me a list of everything Khomeini would not like to be done to him and that we could do, and it wouldn't incite condemnation of us by our friends, right? And this is a reference to CIA covert operation. We're still going after that. We've got this on appeal for a declassification because a lot's now known. But we got this through Freedom of Information Act, working on the Iran project. But it exposed us to the idea that there's a weekly report from Zbigniew every Saturday. He wrote this weekly think piece. And we went back to the Carter, filed a bunch of declassification requests, and discovered there's like 400 of these things. And after about number 40, it's like the Secretary of State figured out that the National Security Advisor was giving this backstage memo, so the Secretary of State started writing his own memo. Because they had a debate, Cy Vance versus Zbigniew Brzezinski. So now we've got the Cy Vances under declassification. We should have all of them within the next year. And many of them have Jimmy Carter scribbling on. One of them from Zbigniew, I should have put it in the slideshow, Zbigniew saying, well, we've got to do some, you know, we've got to cover our intentions here and maybe mislead this and that outside. Z, you're telling me you want me to lie? Question mark? JC. Okay, you get a real interesting sense of the internal dynamics when you get documents like that. So this is a preview of an upcoming. This document is in the Iran collection along with several others of the Zbig. They're about Iran because we curate them on the subject front. But we're going to do a complete series because the internal debates are captured in this series like no other series. When you include Carter's handwriting and there's 5,000 pages of unpublished Carter diary, so he's got his thoughts at the end of the day after hearing some of the arguments, all of a sudden you've got this interactive primary source-based story of foreign policy in some of the most momentous years of our history. More on Iran. This is the famous, it's now infamous, in 99, President Clinton's overture to Khatami, the new reformers that I was mentioning before. And it's got a great backstory. I won't go into it, but he basically says to Khatami, you know, you got bad guys working for you at the Revolutionary Guard, and they're killing Americans, and we're going to hold you responsible. Now, a smarter diplomatic move would have been to say, you're the reformers. We know you got bad guys. Let's work with you to enhance your power. Instead, the United States blamed Khatami for stuff he couldn't control in the least, the Revolutionary Guards. So one of the great, but this document that we've gotten it through Freedom of Information Act and a bunch of the argument documents because people inside the National Security Council said to him, don't do this message. People in the intelligence committee said, do this message. They're all to blame. They're all bad. And you see this lack, this sort of monolithic approach to foreign countries and the debate against the people who know something and have nuance and maybe speak Farsi, all that. You can see it take place behind this message. Here's the overture. This is through the Swiss. The Iranians say, we'll come talk to you. Now, this is after President George W. Bush called them the axis of evil. This is the Iranian mullahs, right? This is after. But at the same time, that's the year we invaded Iraq. Remember that old saying, the enemy of my enemy is my friend? oh, those Americans, they're taking out Saddam Hussein. Maybe we ought to get into a dialogue with them. And it's a fascinating, you get to see the ups and downs, mostly downs. This one ultimately blew up and a person on the National Security Council resigned because the W. Bush administration refused to do anything with this. So they thought there was actually something here we could get into a dialogue. This is in the new Iran set. This is the CIA estimate about Iran's nuclear program. I love it in the combination with the non-proliferation collection you see here. We judge with high confidence in fall 2003, they stopped. Remember the Swiss overture, 2003? They stopped their nuclear program. Why would they stop their nuclear program in 2003? Is it because they no longer had Iraq as a threat? I mean, think about the interactivity of our policy, and I think this is the kind of document that then students and scholars look at this and go, wow, that's fascinating. This document then became the basis for the whole negotiation of the Iran nuclear deal that the Europeans, Russians, Chinese are all still part of and we've pulled out of. And the Iranians are throwing temper tantrums now, and you can see it on the front pages. But this gives you the historical context and the documents sort of behind. Let me just segue. This will be in our next, we have already Iraq War I, which has all the planning documents and all the exercises leading up to the invasion of Iraq. This will be in Iraq War II, which is what happened when, as Colin Powell said, pottery barn rule, you break it, you own it. You break Iran, you're responsible. This is the Army's internal history, big internal debate. They finally declassified it earlier this year. And they basically say the only winner of the Iraq War, Iran. Think of just geopolitically think about that and how that opens your eyes to then what are the underlying history. And this is the Army historian saying this. It's not me. It's not some critic of the Iraq War. But so that'll be next up, the an Iraq War set. This will be in that next collection too. Turns out after the discovery that there were no weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, the CIA, full of professionals, went back and did a whole series. How could we be so wrong? They really did believe it wasn't just cherry picking at the White House of Intelligence. It was serious intelligence professionals who failed because they believed he still had them. And so on page 16 of this particular document, it's one of six that we got loose through Freedom of Information requests. The CIA says the reason we were wrong is we never put ourselves in Saddam Hussein's shoes. We looked at all of his deceptions and said, he's lying. He's lying here, he's lying there, he's lying there, he's lying there. He must be hiding nukes. He must be hiding. What he was hiding was the absence of nukes. The analysts say, he lives in a dangerous neighborhood. He didn't want the neighbors to know he didn't have them. Right? Exactly. Well, if it enriches uranium, yeah. But this is a fascinating because this is a lesson not just for intelligence analysts, but for historians and for scholars of all kinds. It's to look at the evidence and see how are you reading the evidence and are you questioning your own assumptions and what are you going in with and what are the frames that you're using. And this whole series is just, it's a fascinating case study. There have already been three master's theses have been written on just on this series, and I bet there'll be some dissertations down the road. So this whole series will be in our next Iraq collection. Let me segue over to here. Another great upcoming collection. This is Donald Rumsfeld. He wrote a series of documents, about 60,000 of them, called the Snowflakes. And they're called the Snowflakes because people at the Pentagon, they descended on the Pentagon like a blizzard, right? Some of them are one line, some of them are one page, some of them are one paragraph, and some of them like this are two pages. And this is one of the most genius documents from 2003. Global War on Terrorism. What are our metrics? He says, are we capturing, killing, disarming, or dissuading more terrorists every day than the madrasas and radical clerics are recruiting against us? Isn't that a core question in the global war on terror? There's another way to ask that question, which is to say, are we killing them faster than our killing is helping create them, right? Because there's an interactive dynamic there too. What's fascinating about this is that all these different people, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Deputy Secretary of Defense, Vice Chair of the Joint and future Chair, and the Undersecretary for Policy, each wrote a response. Here's what I think. And it's interesting because there are real variables between the military and the civilians in terms of their answers to these questions. This series, The Snowflakes, is basically an almost hour by hour, minute by minute of 2001 to 2007. 9/11, pre-9/11 and the warnings and the lack of attention paid, the sense of astonishment, guilt, and oh my God, if this happens again, this is the worst thing possible. The over-response in a way to 9/11, the invasion of Afghanistan, invasion of Iraq, the whole series, but it's going to be an essential, I think, tool chronologically and otherwise, and really unique because it's what Rumsfeld, the Secretary of Defense, was thinking hourly or minute by minute all the way through this incredible period, and also what he was not thinking about and what was distracting him and how much focus did he have there. And so there's going to be incredible data analysis that people are going to be able to do just with a content analysis of what he's caring about. What's he dictate on this particular day? He does something on procurement. He does something in Afghanistan. He does something here. What's the level of attention paid? I think it's going to lead as a data set to some extraordinary new scholarship. So this was in May in the Washington Post, an editorial saying, "We love that National Security Archive, a leading nonprofit research group at GW, uses the Freedom of Information Act extensively, and there's our partners at the Society for Historians of Foreign Relations. They've sued the Trump administration to force the president to keep records of his meetings." Because there are five meetings with Putin where the Washington Post has reported that senior officials have no access to a memcon, a transcript, or even a summary. There's at least two meetings with Kim Jong-un where the president met with the North Korean leader with only a North Korean translator present. There are two meetings, one between the president and the Saudi Prince Mohammed, and one between the president's son-in-law, Jared Kushner, and the Saudi Prince Mohammed, where apparently no records have kept. And then there's a visual piece of video from a Hamburg sidelines meeting where Trump comes out of a back room with Putin, and he's walking right behind the American interpreter, and he reaches out and grabs her notebook and takes it away. And when you put that together with my favorite passage, I should have put it in this slide, favorite passage from the Mueller report is based on the testimony of the White House counsel, Don McGahn. And according to McGahn's testimony, there was a point where the president turns to him, near the end of McGahn's tenure, I should say, says, What are you writing? What are you writing there? And McGahn says, I'm just taking notes. What do you mean taking notes? What do you mean taking notes? Yeah, I'm a lawyer and I record what goes on in meetings and what people say. The president says, this is sworn testimony, I've had a lot of lawyers. None of them ever took notes. I don't want you taking any notes. Stop taking those notes. Seriously. So we got a problem if we can't document what is said at the highest levels. We have a problem not just for history, but for accountability, and not just for accountability, for even the rest of the government knowing what to do to follow up. It's like we've moved from the, even Richard Nixon didn't destroy his Watergate tapes because he wanted to use them for his memoirs. He thought it gave him power to know what was actually said. And I think we have a different style at the top today that's a little bit closer to maybe New York real estate or mafia interactions. Anybody seen The Godfather? Don't take notes, right? Where you don't want it written down because then it could be used against you. So this is where we are. When you subscribe to the Digital National Security Archive, you're helping make possible. We're doing this not by paying lawyers. The big commercial firm Baker McKenzie is doing this pro bono for us because it's for history. It's for accountability. And all of our Freedom of Information lawsuits are done with pro bono firms. So you're getting a huge leverage effect from your investment in the Digital National Security Archive. So I'll end with this, award-winning. You're not just getting an award-winning database. You're getting a part of a cause. And this is just one of my favorite moments. Richard Nixon met Fidel Castro in New York City in 1959, sitting vice president, brand new leader of Cuba. This is one of the key documents in the Cuba Dialogue collection you have on your list. And what I really loved about this is that Nixon then wrote up his impressions of Castro as a memo, six-page memo, to the rest of the government. And it's fascinating. Whatever we think of him, he's going to be a strong factor in the development of Cuba. He seems to be sincere. He's incredibly naive or under-disciplined. But I don't think he's yet a communist, right? And he's got those indefinable qualities that make him a leader of men. very insightful. We then had to deal with Castro for the next, 50 years. And Nixon gives a really good biographical introduction to the whole subject. So I'll leave it there. Thank you. Thank you all very much.